Yada-da, shit nigga Yuck Mouth, man. And we rocking out on Only Touch Greatness Podcast, baby. Check out the new interview, man. We went in, my friend. Yada-da, fuck!
Kinda broke the scene, y'all, so all I got is fire.
Player, give me some brew and I might just chill. But I'm the type that likes to light another joint like Cypress Hill. I still do be spit loogies when I puff on it. I got some bucks on it, but it ain't enough on it. Go get the STIDES. Nevertheless, I'm hella fresh, rolling joints like a cigarette.
Don't cry, dry your eyes, say pop, we still ballin'. Look up in the sky, say, still, pop, we still ballin'.
Still got a habit, still a shittin' pee-pee on you faggots, nigga. We still under the sun, man. Dre, Yuck, and Nelly, take over, my nigga.
Welcome to the bank.
Yeah, put us back on the map, bitch. We put crack on the map. Those fiends get slapped with a bat. Bitch, niggas get capped with a gap. Let them know what he at. Back to back, business and lax, real max, pimp bitches on tracks. Real thugs get bitches off crack. Why the snitches get whacked? Let them know what he at.
Got a bad Spanish bitch, think she cat stacks. All she brag about is fucking niggas that rap. For that fat cat, you gotta have a rat pack. Ciroc, moon rock, and a gas pack. It make her throw that ass back, throw that ass back. Matte black Porsche, bitch, watch where you ash that. Smash that, I'm a hashtag Black Mac. Pass that to the lil' homie, let him have.
Pack a kush for the bandana. You keep a bag full of midget. Bad Santa. I'm iller than Cool J with the Black Panther. Smoking jackhammers with ass clappers and lap dancers. Detroit bitches got more ass than Atlanta. Blow a bag to get skull gang, no Santana.
Dead presidents meet the plug at the residence. Elegant thug, McCarty frames came from slain elephants. My niggas win the trial. Regime general, the road to Emerald Dow. I'm a criminal. I'm back, it's been a while. These fuck niggas foul. Time a nigga cock back to Mac and knock a nigga.
Looking for the most beers on tap? Great steaks, great staff? Head over to the John B. Pub.
We got the best beers, steaks, chicken wings, nachos in town. Come see us at the John B. Pub.
The John B. Pub, the best bar in town. Come sign up for our football pool. Say hey, St. You.
The number one sports podcast in Vancouver with Ryan Hayes and Big Mike.
Ryan Hayes and Big Mike.
I never stop.
I only touch greatness podcast
in Vancouver.
Get down or lay down.
Nigga neck and his wrist wet. I let the birds fly high, call it Dipset. White girls going wild, call it incest. Turn the 9-piece to a 500-bin stretch. Keep that Pyrex jerking. Got my.
How you doing? I had to make sure I threw on the Oakland gear and the Marshawn Lynch for you.
Ah, shit, town business, man. Good shit. Good shit. Yeah.
I'm Ryan, by the way. I'm up here in Vancouver, Canada.
All right.
And I'm joined with you.
Big Mike here in Vancouver, Canada, too, man. Thank you very much for taking the time for us. Appreciate it.
Oh, man, let's get it. Let's get it. Hold on. It's all good. Let's get it going.
Yeah. And I just want to let you – we got Prince Allen joining us.
Yeah, little boy, Prince Allen from KC. Yo, been loving you. Hey, been loving you for years since the motherfucking the Looney's tapes, man. So
yeah, good shit, man. Appreciate it, man.
Much love.
KC in the building, man. That's what's
up. Know
man.
You know it. That KC, man, love. You already know already.
Your boys, man, they lost, man, but I think y'all gonna make it next year.
Oh yeah, right. I don't know yet. They might not have Honey Badger, so I don't know yet.
Oh shit! Somebody ain't coming back next year.
Yeah, I don't think we don't know if Honey Badger's gonna be there, so I don't know. They getting a little crushed.
Hey, as long as y'all got my home, y'all good, my nigga. Period.
Right. That's for sure. Right, yeah, that is fact.
Over. Y'all got a chance.
Right.
So, I like that you're drinking because we got a drinking game tonight. It's because it's okay. Our special event here. So we got a drinking game. Every time Prince Allen in Kansas City gives a shout out to a friend that I don't know in Canada, or RIP to somebody else I don't know. We do a drinking game, so you drink your drinks. So,
already know. Yeah. Okay. So that's one thing I'm going to say right now. Free my boy Ryan, the high head, right now. Y'all got to take a shake right now on that one. You know,
yeah, somebody I don't know, but I like that guy. Born in Oakland, what was childhood like for you growing up in the 80s?
I had both sides. I could say I had the ghetto life and I had the better side of life. So growing up with my mom, I was raised in the project, man, the 65 Village, man. And it's a project across the street called 69 Village. Both of those two projects is my neighborhood. It's called the Ville. So just raised in there, man. Section 8, welfare, you know what I mean? Struggling. And my pops had a bag. My pops was a musician, you know what I mean? Engineer. Construction worker, so he was working at BMW, you know what I mean, building engines from scratch, you know what I mean, plus hustling on the side. So I go stay with him and had a better side of life, you know what I mean. He stayed on the other side of the Golden Gate Bridge, Sausalito, you know what I mean, Marin City. So when I stayed with him, I went to school out there in Sausalito, school called Bayside. I'm in the third grade and we all had computers at our desks, and this is like 83, just like when a computer first came out. And then I go back to the hood, you know, two years later, and we sharing books and we, you know, sharing textbook and shit. So when you raised up in a rich area, it was different, you know what I mean? Definitely. So I just had both sides. I had the rich side, you know what I mean, having money with my dad, and I had the struggle side. So, you know, I got both sides of life. Far as me in the neighborhood, I don't think if I wasn't raised in the circumstances I was in, I wouldn't be the person I am today. I learned how to draw in the projects. You know what I mean? My homeboy, you know what I mean, used to collect comic books, and we used to collect comic books together and start drawing and shit. So that's how I learned how to draw, learned how to do music in my neighborhood. Everybody was rapping, going around beating on their chest and shit, and rapping and write rhymes, beating on tables and shit in cars. So start rapping because of my neighborhood. Another one, I wouldn't be at Rap a Lot if it wasn't for my neighborhood. An artist named Seagram Miller. You know, was the first artist on the West Coast signed to Rap a Lot. Recipe Seagram, he's from my neighborhood. So my neighborhood, I mean, they already had a deal with Rap a Lot in the 80s. You know what I mean? Late 80s, early 90s. So my whole neighborhood was Rap a Lot the fuck out, period. So, you know, fast forward time, you know, on my solo deal, I go to Rap a Lot because my hood was already working at Rap a Lot. A lot of my people were employed over there. You know, the homie was already over there, Seagram. Yeah, so it was only right I went to Rap a Lot. But yeah, just growing up in Oakland, man, I have both sides of the coin, man. And that's what made me become, you know, who I am today.
So a little about me. I'm basically an A&R out in Vancouver, and I was always the middleman on all the tracks. I got tracks sent to me, I sent them out. I did what Khaled did before Khaled made it cool. Okay. And then basically what you brought up, a name, Seagram Miller. Octavius is, that's my buddy Octavius's brother, of course, right?
Right, the legend. Right. That's his fan.
I'm also from the West Coast Hip Hop Awards, is where I ran into you once back in the day, I believe. And because with Octavius and his award show, right?
Right. Shout out to Octavius, man. Won a lot of awards at the hip hop awards. Yeah. Man. So yeah, that's his brother. So that connection, man, the Seagram Miller connection was a connection to Rap a Lot. You know what I mean? And that's why I ended up going to Rap a Lot. So yeah, this the neighborhood got a lot of history, man. Period. So yeah.
Okay. Did you play any sports growing up?
Baseball, little league baseball, and basketball. You know what I mean? I played those two growing up. But was really into just, you know what I mean, hustling, man. I was a hustler, man. I threw all that shit out the window and started hustling, man, period. And once I started hustling, man, that's when I was locked down, started getting locked up so much. That's when I started focusing on rap, when I did a year. You know, so if I wasn't hustling and all that shit, I wouldn't even be a rapper. You know what I mean? Because I would have been, I mean, if I didn't get caught, you know what I mean? I don't think I'd be a rapper because I would have probably been back out there hustling and shit. But it sat me down for a year. I had a long time to think. I plotted up the whole shit, you know, thought of the group name, which is the Looney Tunes. I thought of my name, Yuck Mouth, thought of Numbskull name, Numbskull, drew the Condom Man, the logo, did everything in Juvenile Hall, got out. You know what I mean? I also wrote the Ice Cream Man, everything in Juvenile Hall. Got out, told Numb about the plan. He changed his name to Numbskull. He was the skinny one at first. Changed his name to Numbskull, and we became the Looney Tunes when I got out of jail. The song I wrote in jail, Ice Cream Man, was a song that got us our record deal. You know, I said that to our executive producer. I'm gonna keep it a buck, man. He was at the trap, and we turned the drug deal into a record deal. I guarantee it's not a soda rock. You can bring cash, money, food stamps, so we can swap. We was there to buy some drugs in a drought. You know what I mean? To buy some coke to, you know, go sell on the block. When it's a drought, that means nobody got to work. You know what I mean? And the price is up. So we knew somebody that had to work, and our executive producer was there at the trap, and he knows Too Short. So we like, yo, fuck this, this whatever going on right here. We rap. And he like, for real? He like, bust one. So I get up and bust the Ice Cream Man. You know what I mean? And he's like, yo, I got my own label. I got my artist named Drew Down. Y'all come to the studio tomorrow, man. I want to sign y'all. So that's how we got our record deal. We turned the drug deal into a record deal. So that's how we got in the game. So all the criminal activity, it all comes together because it all ended. You know what I mean? And it all landed up into hip hop, you know, from me going to jail, writing all the rhymes and coming up with the whole plot of Looney Tunes to actually turning a drug deal into a record deal. So I don't regret, you know what I mean, the hustle aspect, because that's how we got signed.
Who really influenced you as a young artist growing up? Like, who did you always want to try to be like, or not be like, but like, did you take stuff from, look up to?
My favorite artist, I'm gonna keep it a buck, Ice Cube, you know what I mean, NWA, and Ghetto Boys, Scarface, Ghetto Boys. Them was my favorite, period. And then everything that came up under that, you know what I mean? DOC, I liked Kool G Rap, you know what I mean? I liked Rakim, I liked KRS-One, Public Enemy, you know what I mean? Big Daddy Kane, Too Short, Hammer, you know what I mean? Because they from my sector, you know what I mean? So they made us, you know, they made Oakland what it was back then, and, you know what I mean? So, yeah, just basically them dudes that started this shit, man. You know what I mean? That the first dudes in rap and gangster rap, you know what I mean? That really put on for the West Coast. That's who I look up to.
Okay.
And speaking of Seagram's too, what was one of your favorite Seagram's tracks?
Sleeping in My Nikes.
The motherfucker was hard.
The Ville was my number one song, though, man. The song that he made about our neighborhood called The Ville. The Ville.
Yep.
Yeah, that's the anthem in my neighborhood, man. So The Ville is number one. Then Sleeping in My Nights got to be number two. You know, number three is the one that that we did, man. Yuck and Seagulls Ride.
I just thought of it now. I should have sent the link to Octavius to drop in.
Tell I could fuck with it, man. That's my boy.
Yeah, of course. I should have been on that. Had I thought of it.
You didn't know the connection? You forgot?
No, I know.
Oh, shoot. I could probably hit him up. Oh, hold on. I might have to hit him up.
Wait, what is that? You smoking a blunt through the nostril?
Yeah, man. I had dental work, so I can't smoke through my mouth.
Oh, okay.
Oh, cool. Wow.
Yeah. That makes sense. Yeah.
But shout out Bishop Don Juan, man. I learned how to do the nostril smoke like Bishop Don Juan and Snoop. They do this normally. You know what I mean? I'm just doing it because I can't smoke through my mouth.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Who first took you to the studio, and what age did you start taking it serious?
Our first time we went to the studio was us. You know what I mean? Me, Numbskull, Keon, Kevin Choice. We was called Brothers with Potential. Our first group in junior high school, the eighth grade. And Keon and Kevin Choice, they had these, they had their home equipment, you know what I mean? So we was recording at their house, you know what I mean? At their house after school. So then we went to a big studio and recorded the shit, but we paid for it out of our pockets, you know what I mean? So first time I was in a real studio was in the eighth grade. And then, you know, later on after that, after I got out of jail, 12th grade, you know, after I graduated, after I took the GED, when I turned 18, second time we get in the studios when CNH, you know what I mean? See No Records signs us, and we actually do the song Ice Cream Man. know.
See, that's now, yeah, that's awesome that this is happening. Like, am I putting it all together? It's like connecting the dots of like I've been circling you for years trying to get a hold of you for like even back when I was in A&R, I never got a chance to actually work with you. And now when we put it all together, of course, and then being at the West Coast Hip Hop Awards, and I was there when you were there, but I don't think introduced myself to you. I did drink a lot back then.
What do you mean back then?
Yeah. Hey, shout out Numbskull. I'm smoking a lot. He drank a lot. So you definitely is part of the Numbskull drink a lot crew.
Yes, sir. That is for sure. And I got five on it. Obviously, your biggest. I think it's your biggest hit. Do you think it's your biggest hit?
Shit, you lying, man. That's our only hit. Shit. Yep. No. Biggest. This is okay. The only hit. That's a super one hit wonder right there. But yeah.
I didn't want to be the one. Biggest. I didn't want to be the one to say that, but okay.
Hey, I don't know, because that album was lit. I ain't gonna lie. The one with you and Richie Rich, I still bump to this day.
Yep. That's another
hustlers. Yep. Pimps, Players, Hustlers. Yeah. And we actually had him sing it too.
Yeah, none of that hit like five on it in that remix.
Oh, them yes, two, yes,
them,
sir.
Them two fucked it up. That shit went triple platinum by itself. So, and including the platinum album, that's four times platinum. So, yeah, we ain't had no success like that since.
Do you have any like pre show rituals or routines you do before you go out and perform?
No, just smoking. You know what I mean? We like to smoke and vibe out. You know what I mean? Have a little sippy sip. I hate going on stage sober. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's a nervous thing. Like, you be nervous. You know what I mean? You want to smoke and calm your nerves down. You know what I mean? It's like a fighter. When you go into that cage, you nervous. You know what I mean? So, yeah, you nervous as fuck. You don't want to fuck up. You know what I mean? So, I usually have a couple drinks and some smoke. You know what I mean? Just to level me out. You know what I mean? So, I could just relax. You know what I mean? At the same time, you hype, you know what I mean? You know what I mean? So, yeah, man, sometimes you get nervous, though, you know? So I definitely love to just be a little, you know what I mean, a little buzz when I go on stage. I don't like to be sober. It seems like you sober. It just shows a whack to me if they sober, to me. If I'm lit and the crowd, it just feels much better. Jake, you fucked up. My dog keep trying to come in. I ain't doing that. He fucked up. He left me. You're staying out.
What kind of dog you got?
A fucking deer chihuahua.
Okay.
I got a French bulldog named Tupac.
Oh shit. Okay. Yeah. I got a fish named Smokey.
There you go.
It's one of them little beta fishes, man. Nigga named Smokey.
And back to five on it though. Did you know you were sitting on a hit?
Yeah. When we first made it, we made it in 93 and we didn't put it out till 95. So we had put that motherfucker in the vault and just continue to work on our mixtape. You know, the first one with the Condom Man on it with Sugar T, everybody on it. Yeah. So we put that motherfucker out in the streets and then that got us our record deal. You know what I mean? Just the buzz in the streets, being on Drew Down album, Ice Cream Man and all that. That got us our record deal. And when we came to that meeting, you know what I mean? They like, what you got? We played them. I got five on it. The rest is history. They're like, y'all already got y'all single. let's make it radio version of it, because the real five on it is the one at the end of the album where me and Numbers going back to back. Like, you got five on it? I got five. What you got, nigga? Damn, I think I got $2 in my sock, nigga. That's the original version. When we just going back to back, going to buy a sack, we had to take that version and make it radio friendly. That version, the first verse, hella long. You know what I mean? So we had to take that verse out and make it radio friendly. You know what I mean? So we took the first verse out and just made it radio friendly with the 16 bars and shit like that. And boom, we restructured it. And it's the version that you hear now. You know what I mean? So we definitely had to go restructure it for the radio. You know what I mean? But all three versions is out. The remix, the radio version, and the original version is all on the album.
Yeah, with inflation these days, you should almost have a song called 10 on it.
Oh, right. Definitely. But at that time, we was broke. You know what I mean? Yeah. We was teenagers. You know what I mean? Broke. We was only 18. You know, so we was broke, you know what I mean? And
I remember
people still going to purchase, you know, like at that time we had sacks. You couldn't go to the cannabis club and grab, you know, a 7 or 8 or none of that shit. They were selling nickels and dimes and 20s, you know, and shit. And a crew, you have a crew of 2 or 3 dudes, you know what I mean? 4 dudes and everybody pitching 5, you get you a 20 sack. 2 dudes pitching 5, get you a 10 sack. And that was this tradition back in the fucking late 80s. Early 90s, that's how you was able to purchase weed. So we just made a song about it, you know what I mean?
And you released 4 albums on Rap-A-Lot with a former guest of ours, Jay Prince.
Yeah,
we had him on here somehow. We got a hold of him and had the legend on here. Which one of those albums do you look back on as your being your favorite, and what was your time like with Jay Prince?
The best album is Thugged Out the Abolition. That's the one that went platinum. So definitely the first album, the double CD, with the red and blue CD, man. That's classic. Everybody loved that album. I love that album. You know what I mean? And it wasn't even supposed to be a double album. We was working on just Thugged Out. And us waiting, we had to wait 2 years for the executive producer that we assigned to, you know, me and Numb, we assigned to CNH, CNO Records. So it took him 2 years to sign off for me to be at Rap-A-Lot. So during that whole 2 years, I'm working on the album. You know, we wasn't even supposed to be waiting a week for the sign off, let alone 2 years. But he tried to delay it and make, you know, the process more crazy, and it didn't work. You know, he basically tried to, you know, delay it so much that they wouldn't want to sign me. But that 2 years, we just working, kept working. And we come up with, damn near 30-something songs. And we like, they all hot. We putting them all out. And this right after Tupac had dropped the double CD, Me Against the World. This when Biggie had dropped the double, you know. So it was double CD time, you know. So we like, fuck, let's drop a double CD and call it the Abolition. You know what I mean? Instead of just Thugged Out, we call it Thugged Out the Abolition. So waiting for him was an actual blessing, because that's how that album became a double album. And that's what made the album so hot, because it was a double album, had all those songs on it. You know what I mean? So, yeah, definitely. And then us being, like I said, I explained that we had already had Seagram Miller over at Rap-A-Lot. You know what I mean? And when we signed to Virgin Records, Rap-A-Lot had a deal over there also. So we as label mates at that time. So our producer, you know what I mean, Tone Capone, who made 5 on and a lot of other songs on the Looney album, yeah. Rap-A-Lot started hiring him to co-produce with Mike Dean, who's, you know what I mean, who, you know, of course, discovered Kid Cudi, you know, do all the shit for Kanye and everything else. Not Kid Cudi, but Travis Scott. That's his artist. So Mike Dean, that's over there with Kanye and them, he was at Rap-A-Lot at first. You know, he was doing all the shit for the Ghetto Boys and Scarface and shit. So they teamed up. The dude that made 5 on it, Tone Capone and Mike Dean. So they teaming up, making Scarface, the Untouchable album, made the whole album together. While we all in the same studio working. So while they doing Untouchable and they dropped a beat over there, then Scarface do his raps. While he doing his raps, they'd be in the studio making beats for the Looney's album also, which was Lunatic Music. So, during that process, Numb wasn't in the studio a lot. I was always in the studio. And every time Jay Prince is in the studio, you know, the Scarface studio, they'd come to our studio, you know, while they waiting for shit to be mixed and mastered. They'd walk over to our studio, and Jay would always just see me in the studio putting the shit together. And it was like 4 or 5 times where he's like, yo, the last time he came, he's like, yo, you need to do this shit yourself. He's like, you the only one in this motherfucker, man. He's like, you need a solo deal. I was like, God damn, you're right. I never thought of it. I'm a team player. I never thought about going solo. So once he said it, I'm realizing like, damn, I am doing all the work. I'm just leaving an open verse for niggas. Like, I'm in this motherfucker really putting it in by myself. He made me realize that if you're doing all the work, you need a solo deal. So, you know, from then on, you know, I went to Rap-A-Lot after the Lunatic Music, went over there, and shit, the rest is history, you know?
And then, of course, you paid homage with your, I believe that's what you did. You paid homage to Rap-A-Lot by calling your label Smoke-A-Lot.
Nah, I was Smoke-A-Lot before I went to Rap-A-Lot. But I paid homage to Rap-A-Lot because we was already Smoke-A-Lot and drank a lot in our neighborhood, like since the end of the 80s and early 90s when Seagram was signed to Rap-A-Lot. We had crews in the village. We had a drink a lot crew and we had a Smoke-A-Lot crew. That was my niggas. So when we got signed, you know what I mean? Numb became Drink a lot and I became Smoke a lot. This is before we ever had a meet, ever even knew Rap a lot. Oh. You know what I mean? Was signed to Version, you know what I mean? So yeah, it just, and then he said that. He said, you smoke a lot, you need to be at Rap a lot. I was already Smoke a lot before I signed there, you know? So yeah, that's another reason why he said, if you smoke a lot, you need to be at Rap a lot, period. So that's another one that, yeah.
Mike, yep. Going?
Go ahead with Prince.
Prince?
Yeah, so I had to talk about that Drew Down because you were just talking about, you know, coming up with Drew Down. Can You Feel Me? Off that album, bro, that song, Freaks Come Out. How was it like doing that shit, man? Because that right there is like a certified motherfucking hidden gem. So tell us a little bit about that, you know what I'm saying? Working with Drew Down too, because you've been on a lot of Drew Down shit.
Yeah. Drew Down first album, Fools from the Street, was the intro into the game with all of us, with Drew and us, you know. So our executive producer, you know, it was like how Snoop did the Dog Pound, you know. Or you know, Dre did Snoop, you know, on this album he had Snoop all over it to make the introduction that Snoop's coming next. So with Drew Down's album, you know, they had us all over it with the introduction that we coming next. So yeah, we put our song, Ice Cream Man, supposed to be on our album, Rig Up, Rescue 911, all that was supposed to be us, our songs. And instead, we just put it on Drew Down album, you know, just to get the buzz, you know what I mean? To get the buzz going, like, oh shit, okay, here come these dudes, you know what I mean? So we sacrificed, gave them songs away, you know what I mean, to make a buzz, you know what I mean, to even get the deal, you know what I mean? So we all just went in, like, you know, treated Drew Down album like a Dr. Dre album. We just put all our resources and everything into that album, you know what I mean? And just recording with Drew was like, it was a second nature because Drew accepted us like his little brothers. You know what I mean? There wasn't no hate. He could have said, oh, fuck them niggas. Don't sign them niggas. He had the final say so. And CNH asked him, like, yeah, you feel them niggas? He was like, hell yeah, especially that Yuck Mouth nigga. He from the Ville, nigga. I woo, 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 nigga. I fuck with that. So me and Drew clicked instantly. You know what I mean? Because our neighborhoods is right down the street from each other. So me and Drew start hanging like a motherfucker. And that's how we made Rescue 911, because of me and him used to fuck with each other all the time, you know what I mean, period. So we wrote Rescue 911 at his house, at his grandma's house, you know what I mean? So, me and Drew was definitely connected.
Y'all had some motherfucking cutties, man. I ain't gonna lie, man. Y'all had some cuts. That Who Ride and all that shit, like, if you really look at it, like, Drew Down has some sneaky hits. Like, yeah. But you know what I'm saying? Like, his shit was catchy as a motherfucker. Like, if you ever look at it, you're like, you'd be like, damn, he came out like that. Like, dude, has some shit. And then he could do it all, too. Like, he was on the Wizard of Gangsters. Like, you know what I'm saying? You can see the dude can do it. Like, yo, the motherfuckers are hitting gems.
Yeah, Drew Down on that original Gangsters was hella funny, man. But he could act. He got a full stream and act. He could act his ass off, man. I told him he needed to lean more into that. But yeah, Drew Down, that's a big bro. He put us on. You know what I mean? We got put on with his album, you know what I mean, and with his acceptance, man. So shout out to Drew for, you know, even letting that go down. You know, me and him still mobbing, you know, this regime life, man. He got that dragon, I got the dragon. We all mobbing. But yeah, that's my bro. I'm still my bro to this day.
Are you
still? And I know you. Oh, sorry. Go ahead, Ryan.
Oh, you go ahead, bud.
I was just gonna say, and I know you've performed in a million places. Is there one place that sticks out to you? Your favorite place you ever performed in? Venue was?
Shit, man. It ain't no real favorite spot. You know what I mean? My favorite spot is always home. You know, of course, the Bay Area. Ain't nothing like, I say the Summer Jam, man. I say the Summer Jam that we finally did the Summer Jam, Camiel. You know, that's some shit that everybody want to do. Like, if you're a Bay Area artist, you want to get on that Summer Jam screen. You want to get on that motherfucker. So our first and last time going being at the Summer Jam, because it was a big fight backstage and shit, to where it got too short and them banned from KML and got us banned, you know. So we never did Summer Jam again. But I say that Summer Jam performance was special, you know, because it was for the Bay Area and it was a good look for us, you know, being from the Bay.
What about a dream?
Accomplishing that.
What about a dream venue then?
We did it all, man. We performed at the Madison Square Garden. You know, we sold out the garden with Biggie Smalls. We was on tour with Biggie, Puff, Junior Mafia, Lil' Kim, Mary J. Blige, Jodeci, Naughty by Nature. It was a BET Teen Summit tour. So we was on that thing with Biggie, Naughty, everything. We sold out the Garden. So I did all the arenas, you know, all the big boy arenas, you know.
What was it like sharing the stage with Biggie or having Biggie there?
Biggie was my dude. Rest in peace, Big, man. I was a weed man on tour, man. I was fresh off the street, so I was selling weed. And, you know, being a weed man, everybody fuck with you. You know what I mean? That's how I was with Biggie Smalls 3 days before he got shot in L.A. Because he came to L.A. and he had hit me up. He needs some weed. Like, nigga, yuck, I know yuck got it. So I pulled up, gave him some weed and shit, whatever. Chopped it up with him about Pac and everything. And about faith, you know what I mean? All types of shit. And 3 days later, you know, also we were supposed to get him on Lunatic Music. You know, he was about to, I guess he was supposed to leave to overseas or something. He was like, when he get back, but he ended up staying. I ain't know that, you know, the Puff and them had kept him there. He was supposed to go. He said he was supposed to go overseas or some shit that he told me. And when he get back, he, you know, he'd do the song, but I guess they end up staying in LA longer. And, you know, the misfortunate shit happened. You know what I mean? But yeah, me and Biggie was like this. Lil C's, you know, Junior Mafia, they're my guys, man, period. We was the niggas that was hanging out. Junior Mafia, our age. We young niggas. Yeah. We fucking with the Mafia. You know what I mean? Period. Tearing shit up, terrorizing. We the young niggas on tour. So we click like a motherfucker, man. So yeah, I was hanging with Biggie and Junior Mafia the whole fucking tour. Selling weed to Faith. Faith, that's my homegirl. You know what I mean? Tretch. All of them. They my homies. You know what I mean? Period. So.
Tretch is one of my favorite people in the whole world.
Man, that yoke the motherfucking Joker. That's all I can say. Joker, Joker. I mean, all of his shit. Let's go.
I'm gonna tell you who else was on that. I'm gonna tell you who else was on that tour, and they was opening acts, and they wasn't really nobody yet. Since Jodeci was on the tour, Devontae Swang artist was on that tour, which was Missy Elliott, and Timbaland. They was a group at first. You know what I mean? All in a group together. They was opening for us and Adina Howard. You know what I mean? So yeah, I seen them as some type of group. They was dressed in all leather and stuff like that, looking like the Matrix. This is 95, you know what I mean? Before, yeah, for real. I seen Missy and Timbaland as a group, and they had some other people, but they was all in one group together, and they was opening for us. And then to go down the line to see what Missy does and Timbaland does later on in the game, I was there at the beginning, you know what I mean, and watched them, you know what I mean, go from being a group to like, fuck it, we just going to do Missy, and I'm going to get behind her and do the production. So I watched that, so... Yeah, salute to Missy, but I was there when she was a group with Timbaland, for real.
Damn, that's crazy. Nice, shout out to Devontae Swang. I never knew he did any beats, and he did like a couple of some gems.
Is it Mr. Dalvin? No, it's Devontae Swang. Yeah, he didn't want to do all the beats, so he discovered Timbaland. They was producing together also. So yeah, he discovered Timbaland and Missy.
Hey, right. And shout out to my boy Big Shrek. Hey, go ahead.
What up, man? What up, y'all? King of Oakland.
What it do, Playboy?
What it do? What up? I remember I met you at the Ever Mall with my boy Big Will.
Okay, hell yeah. What's up
with you two? I'll be getting on my boy Big Will, man. When y'all gonna do an album?
Oh man, you better tell him, man. Holla at me, man. It's good.
I've been getting on him crazy, man. And I got a question, buddy, since you know you were so close with Biggie. Did you guys ever do the studio? Got in the studio and did some music?
We were supposed to, but I got in the studio and did some music with Puff Daddy. You know what I mean? We did the Puff Daddy did a remix to Five on it called Satisfy Me with R. Kelly. And Puffy got us for the remix, you know what I mean? Me and Numb. So yeah, we recorded with Puff with J-Lo in the studio when we doing our verses and shit. So yeah, Puff and J-Lo was in the lab when we did our shit.
When they were still together.
Yeah, they were still together. This was 96.
Yep, before the shoot.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
The Shine one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
What's your favorite Looney's album?
I like them. Oh, shit.
Out of all the ones you've done, what is your favorite?
It got to be. I like Operation Shacko. I think that's in Lunatic Music.
That's hard.
I think that's the best one without the hit single on it. That's the best one, I think.
Why you guys didn't ever do I Love In My Nature? Why you guys never did a video for that? That was my jam.
That was the one we wanted to do.
That was my favorite song on the album.
They never lined that up, man. Period. Yeah, they was
that was to, my jam.
In My Nature, we were supposed to do. It was another one on there that we were supposed to do before. And we argued for them to do the Hypnotize one with Redman. Like we
had
to for them to do that. But you know, that was like an A&R album, I want to say, because it was a lot of our first album, Lunatic Music. We did what we wanted to do. The second album, that's when the, you know, the labels want to come in and pitch their ideas and their beats and, oh, you should do a song of this and do this and do this and do this and get this person. So dealing with all their demands that they wanted, that's how the album came out. And when we finished the album, of course, they want to lean on the shit that they did, that they brought to the table instead of the shit that really made sense, like Hustle, In My Nature, and other songs, you know what I mean, that really would have hit. You know what I mean? But instead, they wanted to, you know, keep it like, wanted to lightweight, try to make another five on it. You know, that's why they put out the Just Me and You and, you know, the shit that with the remake type of feel. And it's like, no, we already did that, man. Let's go with what feel better as a better song. Not it got to be a remake and we got to keep doing fucking remakes. So that's where they dropped the ball at. You know what I mean? But it's still a dope ass album. I think that's our dopest album. Besides, it's a High Times album, too, that we put out a couple years ago, man. That High Times album.
Right. I remember that. I remember when that came out because it came. Was that the one that came out on Dat Piff?
Yeah, it was a mixtape.
Yeah, mixtape. Yeah, when I saw that shit, I remember when it came out, I was like, oh, shit. Looney's, I'm like, oh shit, no, I gotta get on this shit real quick. Let me get up in this one real quick. And I swear to God, I still slap it to this day.
Yeah, that thing bang, man. That's what Numb fresh out of jail. You know, Numb did 7 years, man. So when he came home, we got right in the studio. You know, that's why it took so long to do another album because he was locked up. So once he got out, we hot right in the lab and made High Times, you know, and dropped it on 420 weekend, literally, you know.
New drink, everybody. Hey, everybody.
Cheers. Right. Cheers. And speaking of Bay Love, man, I have to say this, man, because it means a lot right now. Like RP motherfucking Mac, motherfucking Drake.
You know
I had to say it.
Drake
motherfucking Ghost to motherfucking Thizzle motherfucking Washington. Boss Tycoon, man. You know, when that motherfucker in Thizzle Washington came out, Nick, everybody was on that bitch. Like, nigga, I remember whenever motherfucking, like, I first ever heard Thizz Dance off that. I was like, who's the fuck? Because Thizz Dance first song that I ever heard from that. So I'm like, yo. I'm like, who's this? I'm like, this a yo, nigga. This that motherfucking nigga from the motherfucking Bay. Too hard for the motherfucking radio himself, Mac Dre. Yo, Boss Tycoon, how was it like making that motherfucker? Because I tell you this day, that's one of the top songs that you could just play and niggas gonna know that shit.
Man, there's a piece to Furley, you know what I mean? Mac Dre to Cuddy, man, that was one of my best friends, man. When Dre got out of jail, man, He wanted to link up with all the hottest niggas in the Bay, man. So he linked up with Three Times Crazy. He linked up with the Mob Figures, rest in peace, Jacka. And he linked up with me, you know what I mean? A nigga from the Loonies, you know what I mean? And linked up with Sacramento niggas, something terrible. Linked up with his niggas, Cutthroat Committee, all these niggas. And he brought us all together, you know what I mean? Just the mob together. So once we was doing all of this, you know what I mean? The first song me and Dre ever did together was Boss Tycoon, where he flew me out to Sacramento. I went to the compound. They had the Thizz compound in Sacramento, which is the crib, you know what I mean? Mini mansion. And recorded that month. No, we didn't record at the mini mansion. We recorded at somebody else. I want to say the producers, Psycho. I want to say we performed at the producer, rest in peace, Psycho. I think we did it at his crib because it was a house studio, you know what I mean? And we recorded in somebody's bedroom. You know what I mean? So it was a house studio. I remember we dizzing hella hard. You know what I mean? Kilo Kirk dizzing and grilling and shit and sweating like a motherfucker, man. Drake dizzing and me smoking good weed. We drinking Remy Martin and shit and niggas going crazy, my nigga. And yeah, we knocked that motherfucker out, man. We wrote it on the spot, wrote everything together. It was just a beat. You know what I mean? He did the hook, nigga, and then we was out of here.
Period. I mean, because when that motherfucker came out, RPQB meme, that nigga was like, we heard that motherfucker. RBC got him against the rappers giving up the middle finger. Ayo, when you hear that song, you just that's the first thing you think. Like, he thought, like, in his head, like, you already know, like, this shit gonna go. You know what I'm saying? And when it came to KC, like, yo, like, speaking of KC too, bro, like, how was it like knowing, you know, that KC and Bay connect, gang? You know what I'm saying? Like, how much that connection was, and how was it? And when was it, like, did Jay just ever tell you, like, hey, man, yo, these niggas just giving us love out here? You know what I'm saying? Like, tell us a little bit, you know, the KC and the Bay connect.
Man, I've been rocking with KC, man. Shout out Tech N9ne, man. He part of this mind shit. He part of this gang shit too.
And he was on one of my favorite albums, Thug Lord, too.
Thugged Out, the Abolition.
Oh, you're Thugged Out. Yes,
First song I ever did with Tech N9ne is one called Stallion. And we did that with MC Ren. That was a remake of She Swallowed It.
Yup. I remember that shit.
So that was my first song I did with Tech. But I've been rocking with Tech since. No, second song I did with Tech. The first song we ever did was Killers on the Payroll on the Loonies album. On Lunatic Music. You know, Killers on the Payroll. So that's the first. So we've been fucking with KC since back then. You know what I mean? Then Dre got out of jail, you know, in the 2000. Well, he'd been out of jail like in 90. He got out of jail in the late 90s, but we started tapping in the 2000s. By that time, you know, it was Messy Marv. Shout out Messy Marv.
Yeah,
you
shout out to Mess.
Andre Nicotina, you know what I mean? Tearing that shit up. You had Yuck Mouth, Looney's tearing shit up. And you had motherfucking Mac Maul and them tearing shit up. You had Mac Dre and them tearing shit up in Kansas City. They loved us, man. They loved the whole Fizz movement. They loved Mac Dre. They loved the Bay. They loved L.A. L.A. niggas was out there, you know what I mean, doing their thing too, man. So we looked at Kansas City like, shit, our second home. You know what I mean? Period. Where they fuck with the Bay Area and they move like the Bay Area. You're going to see them niggas Fizz and Ghost riding they whip and doing all the shit that we do in the Bay. You know what I mean? So it was all bros. You know what I mean? Period. So we love Kansas, straight up.
Right, and we most definitely love y'all too, because hey, we don't go a day without y'all motherfucking music for real. Like we stay playing. Like 50 Rich was just here. You know what I'm saying? Like that's how you know that niggas still gonna show love. You know what I'm saying? No matter what.
Can't forget Jack and the Mile Figures. They was beating. They was going.
Oh
out
yeah, yeah. And so, speaking of Jack and Two, man, RIP to Jack, man. Like you know, niggas loved him out there too. You know what I'm saying? Like that crushed our hearts. You know what I'm saying? Whenever he passed, his anniversary was just what it was like yesterday. You know what I'm saying? Like tell us a lot of hidden gems about Jack and Two, man. You know, shout out to Jack's mom too. It was her birthday. Saying And Trill ENT, I didn't even know the Trill TV with you and him and Mac whenever y'all was just chilling, drinking the genie bottle. Yo, I said, yo, that was Jack the whole motherfucking time.
The whole time, my G. Yeah, man, salute to my bros, man. You know what I mean? Rest in peace, mob in peace to Jacka. No, shout out Roder J. Clyde, Hustler. You know what I mean? AP9, they're my bros, man. So, yeah, we was all mobbing together, man. And they love the shit out the Mob Figures out there, man. But the Mob Figures, I first met them in the 90s, man. That was SIBO's group. You know what I mean? That was SIBO's group. He came up under the SIBO umbrella, West Coast Mafia, man. So I met them at the West Coast, what they record label was called back then. Well, T, they had an executive producer named T, and they had an office in Oakland. It's like damn near by San Leandro, you know what I mean? So I went to their office one time. And that's how I met the Mob Figures and met SIBO at the same time for the very first time. So after that, you know, I started seeing the Mob Figures all through the Bay. I never knew they was from the Bay. And so I seen them, you know what I mean? We start rocking and fucking with each other, man. And it's been that way ever since the early 90s, man, period. So they my bros, period. Like everything that we was doing shit together, man. Like us, the Mob Figures, you know what I mean? Three Times Crazy, the whole Fizz camp. We was doing shit together, just helping each other. You know what I mean? Just helping each other movements, helping each other projects, hopping on each other projects and shit. Keep the Sneak, you know what I mean? All of us, you know what I mean? We all working and fucking with each other, man. So, but with Jacka though, that was like our brother, brother, brother. Because, you know, I got this Regime shit. You know what I mean? So rest in peace to Pretty.
To the fullest.
Rest in peace to Pretty Black. You know what I mean? One of my Regime members, him and the Jacka was like this. So tough to where Pretty Black had his mini mansion. And the Jacka, the Hustler, all the mob figures lived with Pretty Black. Period. Both cribs. You know what I mean? They all, you know, lived in a big crib and they all divvying up, whatever. So that was our brother. That's family. Niggas living in cribs and driving luxury cars and shit. And, you know, that's how we was mopping. You know what I mean? Pretty Black had money over everything. We all mopping. You know what I mean? Period. So that was us. It was the Regime and the mob figures. You know what I mean? Period. Yeah. To this day. You know what I mean? Regime and the mob figures. So those are bro bros. Bro bros. Like, literally. You know what I mean? So mob and peace to Jacka, my nigga. Mob and peace to Pretty Black. You know what I mean? They was best friends like a motherfucker. Period.
I had technical difficulties for a few seconds there, and I had to let Prince run shit for the last couple minutes. So I'd like to jump back in here.
Oh, yeah.
You could. One guy,
yeah, I know royalty rules. You already know it.
Yeah, one guy that we have a friend in common, your boy Rich Rocca. You have the song "Real Ones," one of my top five songs. Your boy's been on the show twice. We're like, I mean, we like each other's shit, so like, I consider him a friend. Yeah, we're friends. And that song, how was that? A song that was done over the internet, or did you guys meet up to do that one?
Over the internet, definitely over the internet. But okay. me and Rock, we fuck with it, man. Period. The long way, man. That's another dude, you know what I mean, coming up out the Bay Area, you know what I mean? That transition to LA. We all out here in LA, man. So when I see my brothers from the Bay in LA, man, I always try to tap in with them, you know what I mean, and try to show that allegiance, you know what I mean? So Rich Rock have been fucking with me since he was your boy.
Yeah. You feel me? And I've been fucking with him since he's been your boy, you know?
Right, right. So, yeah, man, I always dig. You know what I mean? I always thought that nigga had fire. You know what I mean? No Frank Ocean, but he got gas. You know what I mean? Yeah. He'd tear that motherfucker to pieces, man. So, you know, just like Dre, you know what I mean? He wanted to get around the spitters. I always want to be around the dope-ass spitters, and I feel that your boy from Frisco, nigga, one of the tightest niggas to come up out of Frisco, period. Yeah, so, you know, just to have that love, you know what I mean? Just to represent, you know what I mean? I always want to represent just the Bay Area, period, on my album, whether it's some dudes from Frisco, Richmond, whatever, Oakland, Vallejo, Sacramento, you know, North, I want to just rep our sector, always, you know what I mean? And, yeah, your boy was one of them niggas that, yo, you gotta had this nigga on every one of your albums, man. Yeah. So, yeah, and we still doing work together, man. So shout out your boy.
Good, I love that.
Rich Rocca, my nigga.
Yeah, another friend in common. He makes music videos in the Bay. Hatch 86 Films. Have you ever worked with him?
Who?
Hatch 86.
Nah, I haven't worked with him on no films. Not yet.
Okay. Have you heard of him?
But salute to that brother. Yeah, yeah, I heard of him, definitely. Okay. Man. He definitely kick up dust, man. So salute to that brother.
Hey, and you got a song with one of my one of our other guests, future guests too. AD Empire off of Anthems and Icons. You know what I'm saying? It was just self-titled Anthems and Icons. So, how was it? You know, being a part of that too. And shout out, man, to AD Empire, Canadian Connect.
I think they was the first ones to do the Yo Gotti challenge.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And they used the song that I got on. They let independent rappers, you know, rap on their beat and the song that I got on. And everybody was able to do their own versions. You know what I mean? And whoever did the best version, I think, won or whatever. But it was dope. I loved it. It was so many different versions. People had different gas to it. You know what I mean? I guess I ended it with Fuck Cancel Culture, Ghost Chappelle. So a lot of people called it Fuck Cancel Culture. Some people called it Ghost Chappelle, all types of shit. So, yeah, it was dope, though, what the artist was coming up with.
Right.
One question we like to ask all our guests is if you could sit down for dinner or have a dinner party with three guests, dead or alive, who you got?
Shit. Definitely it'd be Michael Jackson, Bob Marley, Bob Marley, Michael Jackson, Bob Marley, and Malcolm X.
Sweet. You have some good smoke with Marley.
Uh-huh. Definitely. Get the knowledge from Malcolm and get the music from Michael.
That's right.
And on another note, there were another friend in common, B Styles. He a guy from, he's from Oregon. And I guess he told me a story that he picked you up with Network in a Helmer and smoked joints with you. I read that so shitty, I'm going to have to edit it, but.
He said so damn shitty. He meant, I don't know what he meant, but a guy from Oregon.
It's because you got me going here, Prince. You're doing. We're playing the drinking game, and you keep going off. And I'm over here getting a little bit tipsy.
Man, right? You are getting like, shout out to B Styles from Oregon, though. Shout out to him.
There we go. We get to drink to that.
I'll sip.
I assume, I assume that happened. I smoked so much weed, I don't remember everybody that I had an encounter with. But, that probably happened. It sounds like the type of typical Yuck Day.
Hey, I wanted to ask one question that I don't know the answer to. But
I know Network. So if he name drop, go there, Network, man, then hey, man, it definitely had to happen.
Yep, that was the question that he wanted. He was supposed to be here, but he's on the road, so he couldn't drop in and ask that question.
Off top, man, definitely.
Okay. And one time you had a song, I believe, where you said the team goes from the Bay to L.A. to Vegas.
Yeah.
Yeah, you called that before it even happened.
Yeah. The writers, man. Shout out Cleo. You know, Cleo gave us a little clue. She's like, hey, the Raiders are going to Vegas. Like, hell no. Believe me, the Raiders will be going to Vegas. Said, all right, Cleo, I got you. And yeah, we wrote it. We did a song called I'm a Raider, man. And we said from the Bay to LA to Las Vegas. And sure enough, man, these motherfuckers are in Vegas right now.
Are you performing there? Like, why aren't you performing at these games?
Our song is about Oakland. You know what I mean?
Even right.
Say I'm a Raider.
Yes.
But we talk about like Oakland history. We don't name like one player on that song. I don't think that's probably the reason why they don't actually, but they could just play the hook.
I'm a Raider, Oakland Raider, from the Bay to LA to Las Vegas. Cause I'm a player, a Bulls player. And if you with me, pop your collar, shake them haters. I'm a Raider, Oakland Raider, from the Bay to LA.
We don't need you to play the verse, just play the fucking hook.
Right. That's all they have to do. They ain't got to do nothing else.
Just let that go.
You know what I mean?
Are the Raiders your favorite sports franchise then?
Definitely favorite football team.
Okay.
Yeah, definitely my favorite football team, man. Definitely.
Do you have a favorite sports franchise?
Shit, man. Out of everything, man, you got a football team, you got a baseball team, you got a goddamn basketball team. Like, yeah, it ain't nothing.
Who's your baseball team?
A's. I'm athletic.
Okay.
I'm an athletic, man, and that shit. I'm a Golden State Laker. So I fuck with the Lakers and the Warriors because I live in L.A. now. I've been in L.A. since, like, 95. So definitely got that since Kobe came. I've been out here. So definitely got that Laker blood in me. And, you know, I'm from the Bay. I'm from Oakland. And I start off as a Warrior. You know what I mean? So I'm a, you know, Golden State Laker.
And so basically one question I wanted to ask you, can you tell us about, you have a comic book coming out, right?
Yeah, man, it's already out, man. It's called The Legend of Yuck Mouth. We're working on the part two actually right now, which will be dropping this summer. So the part one is out right now, which comes with a soundtrack, man. And fans could go get that at versecomicsusa.com. And just order the book and it's going to come with the soundtrack. We got the part two in the works right now. We're dropping this year with another book and the soundtrack to it. So, yeah, we're doing the comic books, man. Definitely.